Welcome everybody here to what could have been a very, very delayed match, but it's not because the servers are working. Yay! Gosu is going to go up against Experience. Of course, Gosu is not their only name. They are known as, I think it's Gosu Esports is their full name. A lot of people would remember them back in their old clan, which I cannot remember the name of. We're going to jump ourselves inside the game while my brain tries to remember this. Everyone will, however, know Experience. The boys from Sweden, it is Lotus' new team. They had themselves one hell of a lineup too after managing to pull one of those players out from Evil Geniuses, because Evil Geniuses have found themselves two other players to fill up that slot. Hey, gives them six. Yeah, you try and do that kind of math. That's six, by the way. Wow, my brain is actually still not able to remember the name of the team because they played in the BenQ Clash. In fact, I even remember. Easy. There we go. Easy. Oh, wow. Yeah, there's my brain. All right, so we're going to check out this game. So we have our last group stage. So the way it works for the Dota 2 European Challenge, which is the competition which we are currently casting, the teams have fought through the first set of group stages. Two teams from each of those four groups managed to go through. They then got divvied into two separate groups, which was SK Next, EG Fnatic, which we did last night. Of course, you can check out all the broadcasts over on the YouTube channel as well as over on our own 3D TV channel. All the VODs are there. And if you now we have this week, this day, which is Infuse, Gosu, Experience, and SYOL, which is they used to be known as Knee Wave, but they are still from Serbia. Obviously, because the team hasn't changed, it's just the name which has changed. And they are in this group this evening. So we're going to start off with Experience versus Gosu. We're then going to do the Swedish matchup of Infused versus Experience. And then we're going to jump ourselves into the last defense game of the night, which will be Fnatic going up against Team Dignitas. Let's check out this game so far. So we've had ourselves an interesting start so far as far as the draft goes, which means we're going to see some interesting heroes, which we don't always get to see in the same game. They creep in here and there, but they don't always get back into the same game. But we do have Omni Knight being banned as well as Chen, which means Prophet, Brood, NS. There is a lot of options right now that Loader is just like, crap, who do we actually give them? Or do we just say, you know what? You can take one of them, we're going to take the other two. So if you want our Prophet, we'll have Brood, and we'll have ourselves a Nightstalker as well. What you going to do? No, he's going to take out the Broodmother, so he wants to remove out the push. It is one of those things, if you ever want to ban out a hero when you have those options, Broodmother for me is always the one I want to remove, because he just stalls a team up so much. You can't play your normal style when you're going up against a Broodmother. A Broodmother just loves to sit in the side lane, just keep pushing it, and it's that ever-nagging thing in your mind when you're playing against him, going, no matter what happens, if I go down there on the bottom lane to try and stop them, I'm going to have to deal with that Brood on the top lane as well. But I can't. That's on two separate sides of the map. So how do I deal with that? I can't. You just have to push through and just try and make sure the trade-off is worth it. Can make for some fun pushing games, but isn't always the best thing. So now we have XP. They will have a Nightstalker pickup, as well as, well, the choice is there for what they want. More than likely against the NS Windrunner coming up. Normally when you see a Prophet come up and he gets through the ban pool, the normal response is to go with Venomancer as well as Windrunner. That gives you your counter push, and that also gives you the ability to escape on the side lane if you're going to get ganked, and gives you the ability to destroy off the Sprout, and that's an important thing. So there's our NS coming up, and we get to see if Windrunner's not picked up, he'll at least pick up a Quelling Blade. So Venomancer will be the pickup. So that way they have themselves a lot of gank. A lot of gank, in fact. So it's going to be a double slow. There's no official stun in that, but you do have the silence that will come out from Nightstalker if he levels it before the first night time. It's always something Simpson and I love to go, has he leveled silence? No, he hasn't. Shame, shame, shame. But they do have him up, and Nightstalker is just such a great hero for diving. So the Dire will now have to look at a hero that can counter up against the Nightstalker. The normal way of doing it is by grabbing a Slaughter. And while a lot of you go, well, what happened to Beastmaster? Beastmaster used to be the great counter to it because you just pick up the boar. That would slow Nightstalker down when he tried to dive, when NS got himself a BKB, and then you just roar him down. But it's kind of been like this whole thing of you grab yourself a Slaughter, so if Nightstalker ever dives a tower, Amplified Damage is going to cause him to think twice about diving the tower, and Amplified Damage sticks for a very, very long time. And that means the second Nightstalker's finished ganking, he wants to move on to something else to gank. And he won't be able to do that because he's being viewed. Whenever Amplified Damage is on top, you can't get away. But in this case, Gosu are not going to do that. They're going to grab up a Shadow Shaman as well as a Windrunner. So we might have ourselves a big, big pushing lineup, which would work out very, very nicely for Gosu if XP decided, let's go out with a little bit more farm. Let's grab ourselves a Lich as well as a Faceless Void. Yeah, that'll work. No, it won't. Shadow Shaman, so great for the push. Gosu, there's not really a lot that XP can do about defending these towers. Whenever you play with a Venomancer, he needs time to set up. He needs time for levels for to get his wards up. And in that time, you can have Shadow Shaman running a solo mid. He'll get up to level 6. And that means, well, basically those wards are going to be up. They're going to damage down the towers. The Trance will help tank up the damage. And Windrunner will help destroy off the creep wave as well. So if they want to push a T1 tower, there is nothing that XP can do to stop them. And now they've grabbed up Tidehunter as well. The time for XP to fight is not going to be first when those T1 towers go down. If XP hold those T1 towers very early on, then we're going to give them all props, and more than likely they're going to win this game. Because they're going to get level 6 up on Venno, they're going to get his ward levels up, and they're going to get Ravage on the Tidehunter, and Nightstalker will hunt during the nighttime, and he'll look for heroes like Shadow Shaman, or like Windrunner, or if he can, find profit inside the jungle. So there's a lot of options for XP once they get the levels up, but right now, they can have themselves a little bit of trouble in very, very early game. But that also depends on how Gosu play this, if they want to try and run the Shadow Shaman as a solo, or if they run Prophet as a solo and give him the levels. Windrunner, every single hero right now, Shadow Shaman will go solo mid, sometimes solos on, in this case, the safe lane for the Dire is the top lane, and Prophet could be forced to go down the bottom. I'm hoping we don't see that. Prophet inside the jungle is very, very strong as long as he TPs out of the jungle when he needs to. So it's a great way of doing that. And they've already got their bottom lane solo, the Windrunner. If they need to, they can go for a little bit of extra support, and they'll give them a little bit of team fight, and you can look towards the Earthshaker. There's that slot up in. So Lotus currently thinking along the same lines as me, where it's just like, hang on, whoa. Don't want to have a slider, not with a Nightstalker on the field. Faces Void is the ban for Gosu. So they might be thinking the same thing as I was with that Lich support. And then they could run Venomancer as, well, actually, even then, that is something also to take into mind. It has been the current trend around Europe. I don't really know how it's been going with America. I haven't been watching much of the Sunday Evening Cup series. But I generally see them going very, very push. But how does the middle lane work? Does Gosu normally like to go with the dual solo main lane mid? Dual solo lane mid. Yeah, that works. The dual lane mid with the hero which will normally go solo. That's why my brain was getting that mixed up. That would normally go solo and just has a ranged supporter. And that could come from Prophet. I hope to God not. But it could come from Ez, it could come from like a hero like Venomancer or Nightstalker. It's a good combination to run that middle. That means Tidehunter will get a lot more experience on the bottom lane, but that does still mean that XP would require a hero to go up on the top lane as a solo, and then still require a hero on the bottom lane who can take up a little bit of damage and can also deal that. But it needs to be a range hero, because if they couple that with a Tidehunter, they need another range hero down there. Or else Windrunner's just going to have a field day. She's going to keep on coming in nice and close, or at least someone that can come in and jump on Windrunner. And I'm thinking Huskar, if you're looking at that kind of point. But Huskar's also going to have a little bit of trouble because there's a little burst damage, so he probably won't be the best option. Pugna might not be too shabby. DK was the last man out for Loader. Not a bad pick, not a bad ban as well. They kind of see the AA being banned up, and that just signals to Loader that they are thinking about having a little bit more life VS pick up for Gosu. That's going to stop Loader from picking up the Enigma. Well, actually, it might not stop him. He might still go for it. That's going to make him think twice about picking up that Enigma if they're looking for a jungler. Someone that can help balance out the amount of farm they'll be coming out from Prophet. Storm Spirit's going to be a pickup. And that's going to give us our solo mid. So Storm loves to go solo mid, keep up with that rune control. And what makes Storm Spirit even better is because whenever he gets sprouted, all he's got to do is just pop his ultimate. Even if for just a small second, he'll destroy the tree and run himself out. Nice and easy to try and escape. VS will probably look to swap him, but as long as Storm Spirit has mana, as long as Storm Spirit gets a decent start on farm, he should be okay. 10 seconds remaining. But this is still a very, very, like, mid-game heavy kind of thing. Storm Spirit is great once he has his ultimate, because it's very, very difficult to kill him. But what makes it really hard right now is Tide needs his ulti. Venno needs his ulti, or at least levels for wards. Storm Spirit needs his ultimate. Nightstalker doesn't need his ultimate, but he needs a good start to then make the most of his ultimate or make the most of the nighttime. And that's where the clinch is going to be for Loader right now. Who does he have that can give him that kind of pressure in the early game? Who can run that side solo? Who is even going to do that? Do they throw the tri-lane up on the top lane? Who knows? SK is the last pick up for Gosu, so they get themselves some tankability. Some tankability, some lifesteal as well. But more importantly, they have a lot of damage that will come out. And that was one thing they're kind of missing. It was generally a lot of teams, they kind of like overextend themselves on the push, and the amount of damage to deal to focus firing heroes down like a Night Stalker, they never really had that. Windrunner always finds herself filling up that slot. Which she can do as well if she gets a decent amount of crit up. Get Daedalus or an MKB, and if you ever pop a focus fire and a hero is stunned for long enough, then just guaranteed to get that kill. But SK has himself a lot of crit, a big, big crit, if he gets lucky enough to do it. But SK has a lot of crit, he also has a stun, and he also has that ability to respawn again. So if Storm Spirit wants to gank him, and we still have mana up on SK, then yeah, nothing's going to stop it. Actually, now thinking about that, Loader might even think about Mirana. Go to Fusil on Mirana, as well as Manta, and burn the living crap out of that mana on SK, and that'll give them their side lane solo. They need someone with an escape mechanism, and Loader might think about that if they want to look. And people calling out for Puck. Puck is going to be dangerous. The second he gets stunned, you have so many coupling stuns to go on that. Weaver. They're going to go Weaver. Okay. So throwing in a little bit of negative up. Again, this early game. This early game for Gosu was just so critical. So critical. If they deal off a lot of damage, tier 1s to tier 2s, then they've got this game. If they don't, however, then there's trouble. Well, let's jump ourselves through the boys. The boys from Gosu. Paintwhip playing a Shadow Shaman. He is going to head towards that solo middle lane. So Ward galore for us. What do we got for Prophet? We've got Coolhead playing as him. He's bought the Courier, which means he's not going to get that Ring of Basilius off the cuff. In fact, that's going to be bought up by Bulba. But down towards our bottom lane, we have Mike 98, or damn that. Yeah, Mike 88. Is it Mike 88? Yeah, Mike. I'm going to call him Mike 88 because he's IX Mike. Now 1437, because he is one of the most famous players on this side. He'll be playing as our SK on the bottom lane. Prophet is going to head up towards top, and he's going to be pulling. So he's going to be pulling, and it's a slight jungle. It's not a full jungle because he has really got like one clarity potion. That means he's going to be able to get like three creep camps, and that's about it. Smoke gank from XP, but they're not going to find anybody. There's always a bit of a throw with the dice when you use the smoke this early. Unless they're going to do it, I think they're going to do it, and that's set up for middle lane. They're not going to throw a deep ward. There's no real point throwing a ward in that deep. Maybe to bot the creep camp, but I think they're going to look for the Shadow Shaman. And they could do it. So the pings are currently going out. I can see Shadow Shaman in the middle lane, and they can jump this pretty easily. You got yourself a Gush as well as a Gale. Well, you should have a Gale from Aki. Yeah, you do. And that would almost be enough to get a kill if they had someone else to couple it with, and I'm looking at NS, but that's not going to be the case. Slightly interesting for the lineups. Yeah, sorry, I didn't finish going through the lineup for experience. So Loader will be playing as Weaver. He'll be going on the safe lane on the bottom lane, surprisingly. Oh, hello, FES. Double damage. Just spotted out. Support coming through. A DD room for Prophet. Just reminds you of PTG. As Miracle will fall back in the middle lane. Then we're going to have ourselves... It's not going to be a tri-lane. At least it should not be a tri-lane. To throw two melees and a range hero into a tri-lane on the middle... When you've got a possibility of having three range heroes, that's just a waste of XP. So it's not going to happen. NS needs to get those last hits, and he's already going for the build for the urn, so you know he's going to be aggressive. It's what Nightstalker does. Down on the bottom lane, SK just copying a little bit of harassment. Miracle, think about the Gush, he'll actually do it as well. 1437 taking a lot of damage right now. He still has himself another stun, so if anyone wants to dive this, they're not going to do it and profit. You son of a devil! Killing Storm Spirit on the top lane. Frustrating hell. Always got to keep your eye on the Prophet. But on the bright side too, we get to start off with missing first blood. And TP comes back towards the top. So Storm comes back, well, Loader comes back towards the top lane, in fact. He's going to leave the bottom. And lead the bottom to Pycat. He's the one playing as a Storm Spirit who died off first. And Loader will have a little bit of easier time on this. I'm surprised this isn't the starting lanes. Thinking XP thought that maybe we were going to have Windrunner running on that bottom lane. And that way she'll be that side solo, and expecting SK to be up on the safe lane on the top. So maybe just a little bit of an early moment there from experience going, hang on, this isn't the lanes we were expecting. We want to have Weaver going up against a Windrunner. We want to have that range support, and now Venomancer coming across. counterboarding, and well, actually, Venomancer will throw off a Gale, and he's actually dealing a lot of damage. It's because those Alpha Wolves were also attacking on Prophet then. So Aki takes very minimal damage. He pops off one Gale. Sure, Bulba's going to come in and harass him a little bit. Surprising Aki's not throwing at least one hit there into Windrunner. Loader could have been in there pretty soon. They're not doing it in the end. Meanwhile, back in the middle lane, let's keep our eyes on Nightstalker. He's managed to find himself a haste rune, but he's got no bottle to put it in. Prophet's going to TP down towards the bottom lane, so there's been Pycat getting ganked off again. There's nothing Miracle can do right now. He's already throwing the Gush, and Pycat has no level 6, so he can't ulti himself out. Oh, it's a nice Reb. Ah, the Remnant. It did the job. Beautiful play there by Storm Spirit, throwing down the Static Remnant. Made Gosu just think twice about going through. It also makes it harder for those right clicks to hit. I'm seeing double. No, that's a Remnant. But able to live, so Pycat catches a break. And Prophet TP down there for very, very little. And he's going to come back in towards his own jungle, but still no level on Treants. He's just got one-on-one, so he's not jungling at all. He's just moving around the map, controlling the pull. And that is all. Miracle up towards the front lines. Looking for those knives. He knows he can tank that damage. He's tight, he's big, he's fat, and Prophet's TPing again. Will he go in? Will he go in? He's baiting it. Now he's going to go in. They're going to get the kill on Miracle. Is he? Well, actually, he's going to be technically the easier one to kill off. Instead of Storm Spirit, throws down to Revenant, but he's going to really hurt out Vengeful Spirit. They've got to move back, but they've also got to get the kill on Miracle. Pycat does get the kill on the VS, and now Miracle can turn around. The Gale comes in because Aki TP'd himself in, and while there's an overextension dive here from Gozu, it was going to spell three deaths for them. And it's a double kill, more importantly, for Pycat. He gave away the first blood, but now he gets himself something back. And money on a Storm Spirit is nothing you want, let alone the levels. The levels being given to Pycat as well as to that Tide. And now also Shadow Shaman getting called out for a little bit. And we're about to head into nighttime. So that early game time for Gosu, it's just not happening for him. We're not up to level 6 just yet on the Shadow Shaman because we've seen no real ganking in the middle lane. It's been coming up on the top and the bottom. Windrunner's getting up in levels, but Loader, well, hello, just pops off a... Actually, what the hell? That he popped off the south, then got shackled. Go figure. Because he was invis, maybe it didn't trigger. Actually, yeah, there was no damage. Oh, that'll be why. So I needed a right click from Windrunner to stop that south. So it only stops when you take damage. That's the reason why. There's always something logical. There's always a reason logically in Dota. Support coming up towards the top lane, so Aki is back again. Getting shackled to a Kree, and Bulba's now in a little bit of trouble. Loader searching for him. Bulba's got to keep on the run, and there goes the Treants, and the Sprout will hold Loader in place long enough for Prophet to get the kill. But it is at the expense of the Windrunner on top, but to get a couple of levels on Prophet, now I guess that's worth it, but Aki is really pushing this down. He doesn't have himself another Gale. There's that right-click power, the 1-1-1, which happens, and now the two levels on the wards to make it easier for him to push, but just that 1-1 is enough to harass down any form of hero to push them back of a tower. Shadow Shaman, I don't know if he's thinking about going this middle lane, doesn't want to give any money to Nightstalker. TP coming back up towards the top, so Bulba is back. And we're looking for the farm for SK. He's looking pretty low, and well, welcome to nighttime. One level on Silence, three on Void, one on Hunter in the Night. That is the build you should always go when you go in Nightstalker. It's just basically, movement speed's already pretty good as it is. Especially if you manage to farm up some boots. There's that ability to Void, do that damage, get that slow, and have that Silence. Shut down those heroes, and actually couple your abilities. Now we're going to see him dive down the bottom tower. The Creep Wave is there. Titan Storm is too. And wait for him to run through the rear. Looking for the Vengeful Spirit. It's going to be the easier target. Puts the Silence there on SK, so he can't get stunned. The Vengeful Spirit throughout his own stun. And the pool comes back in again. Storm Spirit finds himself with another kill. And we do see NS just hanging over on the side. Pycat wants to destroy off this Creep Wave as fast as he possibly can, and NS is going to come in to give a bit of a hand. That way they can damage down this T1 tower in the bottom lane a lot easier. But while that happens, Gosu pushes out the tier 1 tower in the middle lane. So it's all about the trade, and XP don't have enough pushing power. This is that lack of early game power. They can gank pretty nicely with that Nightstalker, as you just saw. He can dive so easily. But if they try and get, if they get pushed in a lane, there is nothing that XP can do about it.
Dire's top tower is under attack. Radiant's middle tower.
Back up towards the top lane. Bulba trying to deal with these wards. Up at level 3 now too. On the bright side for Bulba is holding this creep wave back next to his own tower. So it's a little bit safer for him. I don't know if we're seeing SKMVS looking for a start, looking for a gank. They got treads up. They could get it too. They got themselves a good double stun as well as a little bit of negative armor and a good damage. How we got? We got one level on crit for SK. It's also, he's got one level in stats, has he? Yeah, he's got one level in stats. Rather surprising. Actually, no, that's coming from this magic stick. No, no, he won one level in stats. Yeah, I'm going nuts. That means that SK. Why does it have that second level on crit? Yeah, oh well. We'll go with that. Venomancer with wards out on the side. Instantly telling experience what's going to be happening on the side. And that's Shadow Shaman. He's up to level 6, or level 7 in fact, and so 4 on Shock and 1 on the Serpent wards. He's going to look for that T1 tower on top. And Loader can't defend that. Bulba can destroy the creep wave very, very easily. And in fact, Shadow Shaman goes back in towards the middle lane. Really surprising he decided to do that. Maybe just holding onto these tier 1 towers is more important to go to right now. But what should be even more important is taking out these tier 1 towers. Shut down that area where Nightstalker feels free to move around the map. Just a reminder to everybody who is tuning in, the Na'Vi game has been postponed. Horvost is currently sick. So Na'Vi wanted to play with their proper roster, which is completely fair enough. So the delay was allowed. So it will be happening on another day, Na'Vi versus Fnatic, but we're going to stick with the Dota 2 European Challenge for a couple of matches, for two of them in fact, and we're going to watch Prophet also get killed on the top lane. There's the Void, Silence, Gale, Bulba will get himself a great shackle right now, and support's going to come in. This could be a chance right now, stun as well in the Nightstalker. Sprout will hold him in place, Aki will TP out, Prophet. Oh, is he TPing into a better position? Lotus can do a lot of damage to this Ventral Spirit. He's got to be really careful. Via's going to go down. Shadow Shaman is running himself through the side. So Storm gets his kill on SK in the meantime on the bottom lane. Now I want to watch Loader on the top lane to see if he can escape right now from Shadow Shaman, who drops the wards. But Loader goes in. Via's also a waste of a wards for Shadow Shaman. That's the more critical thing right now. It's not the fact he was unable to get the kill on Loader. It's the fact that these wards got dropped. So that's a long time before, in fact, a minute and a half and over. Minute and 40 seconds before Shadow Shaman can pressure another tower. I was going to point out another kill for Pycat. So Ring of Basilius, power treads and still has himself another 896 gold. So if he wants to, there's a ring. Loader's in a little bit of trouble, time-lapsing out the damage. An invisible chicken. Got to love the timing of those abilities. But the Hex did go off nonetheless. Never met a chicken that can go into Shuki. It's great. NS, however, he's not really enjoying this time. He's got no kill so far. He's been helping out. For the first nighttime phase, you got to say that's a pretty decent effort to have that earn up. Weaver does finally go down the top lane. Must have just caught him out. Silence as well as Gale. So this will be a kill on the VS. He gets a good stun right now, however, on the Nightstalker. And NS can be real bit careful how far he dives this. Taking a lot of damage from that tower, that negative armor did not help him. He's on low, low life. As the Venomancer got the kill on the VS, and wow, what would you give for some wards right now? They would have that tier 1 tower. SK in the meantime, continuing to get that farm on the bottom. But Aki is also continuing to push out this middle lane. Siege creep in tow, and the TP support is forced to come in from Gosu to stop this push. And a Shadow Shaman again, 6 seconds off his wards. And he would have wanted to plant those around that tier 1 tower on the top lane. Sprout now goes on Aki. Wards again dropping. While it's great to get a kill, those wards are so important to push. A Venomancer kill, yeah, that's okay. It was an NS, a Weaver, hell yeah, drop it. It was a Storm Spirit, hell yes, drop it. And then again, Storm is really, really hard to kill unless if you've got continuous stuns and hexes. It's one thing which is lacking from Gosu. The only other way around is if they burn that mana. So maybe then Windrunner might even herself have to look at Defusal. And Pycat up on the top. Looks like he's going to go for an Orchid. Try and get that Silence up. It's waiting for this push to come in, which is not in the mid tower. Serpent Wars disappear. Miracle's on a bit of a run. Bit of a fast jog. In fact, it's more like a sprint when he's got himself haste. There's someone out the gush saying hi to Shadow Shaman. He pops stick charges and says, yeah, I'm cool, man. Not a problem. Lotus still having fun. 1437 attempting the stun, but really impossible to do so when you have a Weaver. He'll leave the time lapse, it'll just shooky. And 1437 forced to tank the damage. He's got that one level on Ankh, four on stun, one on crit. But he'll be leveling up that crit a lot more. Also, surprising too, if he hasn't leveled up the Vampiric Aura. Such a great thing when you want to try and push down towers. Magosu just not doing that. And they're getting stalled up by experience, but it is daytime again. So an NS will hold on to that ultimate. So for Gosu, it's important they try and bait that ulti out. Prophet ulti just bounces around the map. Helps a little bit more push, and do we have wards up? 3 seconds before they're up. We have Pycat up on the top lane, and that's not going to help the effects of Gosu. That power shot will, however. So the creep wave will basically be next to nothing. So if they want to push this tier 1, they should. And once again, Paint not wanting to do it. He is continuing to rotate between that top lane and the middle lane. Now up with an Ogre Club, so he's looking for a BKB for those fights, but no Blink Dagger to back it up with. So he's not looking to initiate, and Gosu playing a very, very passive game right now. We'll check out our gold graph. I know you guys love that and haven't shown it just yet. So only 250 gold separating the two teams. That's what happens when a lot of teams that not really leaving their lanes, like, sure, we're seeing, I was coming, the Shadow Shaman is just rotating up and down, looking for runes. Not going to find one at the bottom, it's going to find one on the top instead. But just moving in between the lanes, but Prophet is continuing to keep control over these lanes. We're always having either Bulwer up on the top or SK on the bottom. There's always somebody in every single lane for Gosu. And it's the same right now for XP. XP are in most of the lanes. The only lane which they're kind of like letting go a little bit laps is that middle lane, because the tier 1 tower is already gone. There's one lane where they're not really having any form of focus, and that's where the kills make up for it. So it's only what now, 100 gold difference or something like that? So not a lot of difference between the two teams. And when you got 3 kills up, that's just showing that at this point, Gosu are having a better time when it comes to the amount of farm they're getting, the amount of gold they're earning. And we're seeing it too. Mech is almost up for Windrunner. It's going to be critical when Tide wants to jump in. We've got Prophet, who should be looking at a pipe, or at least something. Oh, he might even look at a push, but he should be looking at Sheepstick. It's what he's going to need to try and shut down Storm. I'm looking at a 4-star for SK by the looks of it. TP coming in towards the middle lane. No Shadow Shaman. Still has that illusion rune, about to pop up to level 10. Prophet's going to TP down towards the bottom lane. So looking at Loda, and there goes the first Sprout. He's in range of that tower, so they have vision of him right now. And that's why 1437 is capable of laying this down. But Loda has that time lapse, so will just jump himself out of there. As I said, almost impossible to kill. That's one big thing about experience, and I was going a little bit iffy about it with experiences, like lineup. Saying they really, really require the stun and sentry. They might even have another Sprout. No, 3 seconds on cooldown. And Shadow Shaman too far away. No blink, so he can't catch up. What I wanted to say was it's just a thing which I questioned about the lineup from experience. But I've also got to remember, the second hit level 6, they are very, very elusive. They're almost impossible to kill. NS and Nighttime is next to impossible to kill. Pycat has his ultimate to jump away, and Weaver has time-lapse. So you've got 3 very elusive heroes against a team which does have a lot of stuns, but you can't stun every elusive hero. In the meantime, we do have Pain pushing at that bottom. Surprisingly, not using those wards, letting Loda defend this. And this is the reason why, because then Gosu are just not confident enough to push down the tier 1 towers. It's not even nighttime when they're falling back. But they know that NS can pop that ultimate, but that's also an indication that NS is looking to kill someone. Bulbo does have phase as well as, wow, what is his farm up on the top? 70 for 10. Not the most farmed hero. Loda is actually 86. So he's getting closer and closer to what looks to be a Lincoln Sphere for himself. Not a bad item to go. Gives you a lot of life, and also will make him even more elusive. That's one of those stuns which is not going to work from Gosu. The Hexer won't work. The Sprout doesn't even work on him when you do that. Now Pycat, first stun, secondary stun. In comes Miracle. Think about popping off the Ravage. Money to pop it if he wants to escape out of this. There's still three heroes here. There's no TP support coming in. And Nurse popped off his ultimate. But they get the gank on Pycat. Just overextending Pycat a little bit. Getting himself initially stunned, secondary stun. And that was enough time for them to get the kill. Now the TP coming down towards the bottom lane. And they'll look for Loader. If they can get themselves a Shackle and continue off on this rain of stuns. But this one SK's got to be careful as well. He doesn't want to pop off too many of these little guys. It's sometimes why SKs back in the old day like to go with a Battle Fury. Now where you had that Perseverance, you had the mana regen as well as your health regen. Sure, you can get it from Vampiric Aura, but it was the mana regen which was more important, because if you don't have a, if you don't have 140 mana, your ulti doesn't work. And you got 140 to pop off a Hellfire Blast. That means you need at least 280 if you want to couple both of them together. Miracle's now going to go for VS. It's a good stun, just keeping that ult, that Ravage out. Shackling, loaded to the trees. Miracle will pop off the Ravage. It just managed to get Bulbur on the side. 1437 will still fight this. He still has his ultimate. And also, no, he doesn't have another blast to throw out. So watch 1437. He would love to use it, but he wants to kill off the Venomancer first. So VS for Venom is the current trade. SK was on very, very low life, but he will live through it. Now he gets himself a Meg Charge. Now the silence going on Shadow Shaman. And he does go down too. Loader's able to do enough damage. They still have their Sentry Ward there. As the jump comes up, 1437. The ankle now pops, which means he'll have himself that stun, which he can throw. We'll look for Pycat to stop him off. There's the first stun. Sprout goes up as well. Ghost continues to go. There goes the swap as well as stun. They get the kill on Pycat, but NS is in the middle of him with a DD. And he's going to pick himself up a double kill right now. Great force starving VS away, so he has time to get the stun. Fantastic play there. Who was the one with the four stuff? It was SK. He had completed that for that fight. So a great play there for 1437. Keeping VS alive and not making it a double kill for the NS and claiming his life. And this might also buy them enough time to kill off this tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. So the spike went up to 2k gold advantage to experience before that fight started off when Pycat destroyed the tower. But now the revenge came out from Gosu. That fight just extending on. Prophet's going to TP down as well. And this is something which Aki can't stop. In fact, Aki's going to be careful. Four staff up. There's initiation. First stun. Shackle needs to latch as well. Second TP is going to come in. They know that Anchor's on cooldown for 1437, so he goes up through the trees. Miracle wants to get himself a Gush, gets it as well. Second TP comes in, and this will be the death of 1437. He realizes this too, tries to TP out, will not be able to do so. Pycat not using the pull, saving his mana. Which was a little bit risky, but SK still didn't have ton of TP out. So the damage was dealt. And Loader leads the bottom lane, goes up towards the top lane for farm. Perseverance is almost done. And Lincoln's is only just a hop, skip, and a K away. But just going up and down right now. Now the TP comes up towards top. They want to go for Loader. Sentry Wall will drop Sprout. Loader's just in range, but he time-lapses back up again. And goes out through the rear. Cheeky little Loader. As I said, elusive. Elusive heroes. And the funny thing is, that won't be possible. Loader's going to come back in again. He's going to be careful about this. If VS wants to go again, and VS is probably wanting to, then he could possibly bring down Loader. But Loader also knows once he gets that that Lincoln Sphere up, the Sprout is very, very difficult to cast. When you try and cast it, you can do it two ways. You can cast it to the ground, or you can cast it onto a hero. Onto the hero is a guarantee, basically. Oh, hello, there's our blink. That's what I'm waiting for. Now we've got the good Ravage up, actually, for Miracle in the side. Bulba got caught in it as well. The Ward Trap is still holding NS in place, and what a great Shackle shot onto Miracle. VS swapping him back in range of the ward so they can finish off the job. But it was Prophet's right click that did the job. And Rasta with that blink dagger. Now goes to have the initiation. They got four staff in from the SK with his stun. And the initiation that comes out from the Shadow Shaman blink. And Prophet's going to make the most of this. Make experience try and think twice about stopping them from going for Roshan. And he's going to take out this T1 tower on bottom lane. Take up a little bit of damage. That's fine. You already gave them the Treants. And they all have lifesteal because of 1437. Loader will push down to the T2 tower and will inflict a little bit of damage. And Prophet will have to TP up to deal with that. But Aegis of the Immortal is more important. And this time it will go on 1437. I'm not quite sure about that. I think they need to get it on Shadow Shaman. Of all the heroes, so he can blink in there and do what he needs to. But Roshan is gone. Aegis has given a 1437, so you got him three times over. First from the Aegis, second from the Ankh, But then again, they still got herself a minute and a half on cooldown. And just a reminder for all those other people who have been tuning in, because we are increasing in our numbers as the match goes on. We are currently casting up with the Dota 2 European Challenge. We were supposed to have ourselves with two defense matches tonight, but one of them did get postponed to another day, and that was Na'Vi versus Fnatic. That has been delayed to another day due to the fact that Horvost is sick and is unable to play. We will, however, be covering two of these matches from T2E, depending on our time as well. So Experience versus Gosu. This game kind of looks like it could go down to a nail-biter at the end, but our next match will be coming up at 22 CET for the defense, and maybe at 21 CET, but that's only 10 minutes away, and I really don't think this game is going to be over by then. So we'll probably just wait for our second game for the defense, which will be Team Dignitas going up against DeBoj Fnatic. Boys from Serbia. And that's using Night Tunner Farm. This is not what he wants. What are we looking at? 1, 2, 6. So he's been involved in kills, but just hasn't got them. On the bright side, at least, it doesn't mean he gets earned charges. Push him down the middle lane. Shadow Shaman going to make the most. This time he's really got to drop these walls down early, and he's going to do so as well. Shock this creep wave out and focus on the tower. Storm Spirit jumping himself back down to safety from the high ground. And this will be the death of the tower in the middle lane. Shadow Shaman takes it. And this is the way these wards are meant to work. It's the way Gosu need to attack as well. All the T1 towers are gone. T2 tower is gone as well. So as far as this time of the game, this is looking good for Gosu. As far as map control goes, what's looking bad for them is all their T1 towers are gone as well. That's not what they want to have to deal with. And they don't have to deal with the Weaver, who has that Lincoln Sphere completed now. Support coming out towards the top lane. Did you just see why he's asking if Bizarre the latest or the tournament? If he's just wondering about the courier. Jeremy can always tell it. If you're always wondering what... Actually, no, it doesn't matter, because the courier is the same for both the public versions as well as... the version I'm currently searching for. Latest version. Tournament version and public version. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. There's the newest and the tournament version. That's what they're called. Also got a note tonight. Tonight is patch night. Patch night means we get ourselves a new version of Dota, and it means the tournament version will change around. New heroes added into that. Invoker being the primary one. He will be available when it comes to the tournament version. And that's going to change up our nights of gaming. It means the Infused Cup 2, which we'll be covering this weekend, that will be played with Invoker being available. And a lot of these new changes being added as well. So keep your eyes on joindota.com, because we'll post up the second the patch happens. Power shot flying through. And support now going to go. XP looking for a kill. Storm Spirit's going to jump up. We'll manage to pick up VS at this point. Ghost is going to let him die. They should not have come back just then. And because of that, Lowe's going to find an opening. If NS gets himself another void, but not going to do so. VS being down is great for them, but Prophet popping off the ultimate, and there goes the stun as well. They're looking for NS because the ultimate's worn off. This is why they didn't want to dive. There's a great Ravage, but the BKB is up for Shadow Shaman, shackling the NS in place next to his own wards. They need the damage. They've got the damage. And Prophet catching Loader even out in the back end of play. Restrict his movement a little bit. And Vanuoldi has hit there in 1437, but with that Helm of Iron Will, he's looking for the armlet, finally. Prophet. Just go back to base for mana. He went back to base for a pipe. Okay, that's a lot more important. So pipe is now done for Gosu. They had the Vlad for lifesteal. Do we have mech already up for Windrunner? Miracle comes up, instantly turned into a chicken. Storm Spirit's gonna jump up, looking for three. In fact, Lotus right in the middle of it. 1437, four stops away, but they will lose out. Prophet canceling his TP in. 1437 tries to TP out. How much damage can you do? Enough. The Anchor pop on 1437 will be killed again. Landing off the Sun and Pycat. Balba going to look for a good shackle, but has no mana to do so. This is his problem. He can't even pop off a mech for his team. Prophet's going to TP in. And putting down the Sprout, just holding Venomancer off. VS coming in towards the mix as well. Going to get that Sun on Loader, but Loader going into Shuki just at the right time. Sentry is gone, but he's out of range. So that VS stun won't latch. Can't stun something you don't see. Lashley. You technically can. Well, in this case, you can't. There are some things, Marana, Arrow, SK, and Sandstorm, first thing that comes to mind, that doesn't allow you to stun something which is invisible. Bottom lane, tier 2 towers. It's going to take a little bit of damage, maybe not. Storm Spirit can ulti himself in if he wants to make sure there is not a single iota of damage taken. Oh, one hit from the Siege Creep. Definitely not the best fight for Gosu before, but still keeping it at 0 gold, the difference. Gosu, even though they went wrong when they went down to the tier 2 tower, like, things went wrong for them. It was the best thing that Gosu could have done, because they've got to keep the pressure on the towers. They know experience can out-carry them. SK doesn't have that amount of farm, which says, I am the best carrying hero on this map. There is a Weaver, a Storm Spirit, and an NS. Gosu get outmaneuvered, and they can't get those kills because of it. So the only thing they can do is push, push, push. That's where Prophet has a lot of power. Storm Spirit's jumping up. He's looking to get in close enough, but Pyrecat running out of mana on the way up. And now the stun lands on Pyrecat. Shackle as well. Ravage will buy them some time, but the Piper's already popped off. 1437 wants to finish the job. Pyrecat holds himself away, but the Force Staff goes down. No, oh, Prophet was the one to do it with his ultimate of all things. And now Aki wants to go out. Stun will hold him there as well as the Shackle. Gem of True Sight, they want to kill this off. 1437 will pop, but has enough. Well, he actually had the Aegis Immortal, and that's what's bought them the time. We do have another stun. 1437 needs to cast it. That gem is not going anywhere. The Gush flies out from Miracle. And the gem is picked up by SK, four staffing himself down. Go and look for a stun. Who's it going to be? Loader or Miracle? Miracle is the one they can pick off easy enough. And there is the last right click. Four heroes now gone for experience. And this is the battle Gosu wanted. And they get themselves a free gem. Let's make it a little bit harder for the Weaver. Had to hold on to that gem as long as they could. Say free gem. I think that one's important in the first place. And Prophet can also now, he's got the gem, he's going to be moving around, de-warding. Take out the tier 2 towers, really stop experience's room to move. And the tier 2 tower goes, last hit for Bulba. Weaver's Wave will come in, but that's going to farm these guys up. They are worth 33 gold apiece. Maybe even think about Roshan, just a couple of moments' time. Won't be long before he's back again. SK heads down towards the bottom. What's he going to buy up? What's he going to farm up? Viez and Paint get to have fun in the middle, and his wards are back up again. So the wards have already been used to push and gank. So he's got them again if he wants to go for the tier 2 tower on the bottom lane. And that pipe up on Prophet. I kind of knew it had to come out from somebody. But I was thinking Sheepstick. Oh well. That can come up anyway. He's got himself a decent amount of money. Invis room for the Shadow Shaman. So the possibility for a setup is big for him. How many times he popped up that BKB? Only once. It's pretty decent for him. Save those charges. And 1437 in the meantime continues to farm up. Bulba doing the same. She's looking for Sheepstick, ultimate orb. Or possibly could be looking at Lincoln's as well. There's not many silences and stuns which are going to basically trigger it. So as far as experience getting on top of the wind right now, that would make it next to impossible, but she kind of needs to shut down that storm. So it's all about the stuns. Counter warding from Prophet. Actually using the Sprout for vision. So he can counter ward on the top. Wow, Aki is really prepared for this. That's a lot of wards. You can only get a maximum of 7. They start to time out and die. So you get a maximum of 7 wards. And, well, FaZe is like, I see that, man. I don't have anything to do with that. Bulba TP's up towards the top lane. Realizing Loader is pushing that out. And this can be a big question too, just what type of presence does Loader have when it comes to these fights. At this point, it's a very, very defensive presence. It's very, very difficult to kill him, but they managed to succeed so anyway. But very, very difficult to kill him, but he's dealing very little damage, so there's no Manta style. There's no, there's no Radiance, which is also something I'd like to look at. VS getting caught out in the middle lane, just a little bit too overconfident. And Loader gets that kill. And support coming in towards the mid lane. They're going to look for Paint right now. Paint's a little bit too close. Needs to bring himself away, but he can't pop the BKB. But that Venomancer ward is just cancelling it off. Really fearing it's going to die. They don't want to lose this tier 2 tower. 1437 comes back in defense. And he has finally finished that armlet. Damage yourself, but damage even more. And get him, gain it back with that Vampiric Aura. 25% lifesteal. Not too shabby. could have been a little bit higher. And it's still going to be another two levels before it gets maxed. Loader must have bought a relic. Yep. So more than likely, and basically pretty much a certainty, it's going to be Radiance. Give him that burn, give him that push. Make it a little bit harder for those treants to get in close, and when he does this kind of thing, that right click does so much more damage. Especially with the Germinate. It's a lot of damage, very, very fast. Another Roshan will be done. Negative armor's going to help this out. Just drop him down since that howl of terror, wave of terror. And Aegis the Immortal trying to work out who takes it. It should be SK at this point, and it is going to be SK. Immortality. He's the one that needed it the most. And Nature's Prophet has also gone for another 4-star. So got double 4-star coming out from Gosu. Once again, delaying. They're just not going to go any form of Sheepstick. They're going to count their own disabled as enough. And I got to say, they're going to get to that point where it won't be enough. That damage is done by Weaver. If you lose any of those supportios before the fight starts, you won't have enough. And there's a silence on Storm Spirit. He's had that Orchid for a while, and now he has BKB. So really had to shut Pyke out down during those team fights. They have nothing that goes through BKB. Not a single thing, and that's why BKB is like the most important item to get for experience right now. I'm surprised even Loader went for that Lincolns when he could have gone for the BKB. Because none of these sounds are going to work, but then again, Lincolns is still a great item for him, giving him that extra life. And that's kind of what is probably a little bit more important to Loader. Weaver is a little bit of a squishy hero, and that Radiance is now done, 34 minutes in. Lincolns and Radiance, not the best thing in the world for them. And we'll help that gold graph continue on its current trend, which is basically up. It's going up a long way. It's only 700 gold separating these teams. And SP looking for any advantage. We are in nighttime, and really surprising too that Nightstalker is not popping this ultimate. Whenever you play Nightstalker, if it is nighttime, you pop this ultimate. Extends the nighttime. It stops the time clock completely. So when the ultimate is over, it gets restarted. Radiant had themselves a sentry ward there watching. That's why all those pings are coming out. They're watching Gosu rotating towards the middle. And this might be Gosu's final hurrah down the middle lane. Let's see if they can test. Oh, wow, this time it couldn't have been worse. Miracle has a blink dagger. Oh, this is going to be horrendous for Gosu. They don't know this is coming. They did not know this Tide Ravage is coming, and they want to push in. The Treant army is there. Look for the pipe to pop. But the Ravage is going to come in at the worst time. Look for the blink in. The wars drop as well. And there goes the blink in Ravage. Storm will jump in. They're going to kill off Windrunner to start with. The BKB will pop on Pycat. Venom will pop off the ultimate as well. Bulba is forced back. Pycat continues the chase. The BKBs are up. 1437 is going to go down. This will pop off the Aegis. They're still looking for more. Oh, only one loss, and that's the Venomance. But he got his ultimate off. Now back to 1437 as well as Paint. Who are they going to look at? Loader wants to kill. Gem and True Sight's on the ground. And Ness is looking for somebody, 4-starving up on the high ground, 1437. But Gosu completely taken by surprise. And Storm Spirit able to shut down that Windrunner before she even started up. Couldn't use that Sheepstick at all. And the BKB meant the Pycat couldn't be affected. And now XP get to hit back. A tier 2 tower in the middle lane will more than likely fall. 1437 as well as Paint coming up to stop this. Shotgun and killing. Lanas is looking for the middle lane. 1437 is the one he wants. Lincoln's Fear pops on the first stump, blinking on in, but there goes Miracle as well. Silence is up and 1437 will go down. But he pops his ultimate. And Miracle looking for the anchor, gets it as well. Unable to get the final blow. Prophet's thinking about TPing him, cancels it up. Storm Spirit's only a ulti away, and there he goes! BKB popping from Shadow Shaman, but he's losing too much life! Even with BKB, he can't live through this! VS 4 stops away, the Pycat can chase any place, anytime, anywhere. Prophet pops up the ultimate, trying to slow down this middle push. Any form of attack, and another blink in by Miracle. Gosh, and Storm's going to help set it up too. Silence, 4 starving, 1437 up towards the high ground, but with the Ankh already popped off, it means Weaver is able to pick up that double kill with SK being the second. Tier 2 tower will go down the mid. And Gosu in a horrible position right now. The middle barracks could go down. Bulba trying to hold on. And now Nice Stalker comes up towards the high ground. Sprout will start it off. Shackle as well, holding him to the trees. Weaver Wave is going to help out with this. Then Payne tries to bling himself away so he doesn't get lashed. But Lotus is sitting there right-clicking the tower a little bit. But Gosu hold on to their barracks for now. But that gold graph, as you can see, a big, big spike up 3k in favor of experience. Technically, it's not that much when it comes to this point of the game. But what makes it the most is the fact that experience is the one that has the advantage. And overall team has had an advantage. That's the highest mark. Now 5k, that's a little bit more. But to increase yourself up by 8k in the space of just 5 minutes, that just shows you where this balance is currently shifting. And that's because these carries are getting their farm up. BKB is almost done it for Nice Stalker. He's only a K away from that. Loaded with Lincolns and also has 3,800. So Courier, you're expected to have a Reaver, but it's flying back right now. But Loaded will be looking in for either a Heart or a Manta. And at this point, he'll probably feel confident enough to have a Manta. Make him even more elusive. And a lot of the players for XP back at base. What is Loaded going? He spent money on something. Yeah, it's Yasha. He's going Manta. So wants to have that damage. We'll get the ultimate Orb as well as recipe a little bit later. We'll be able to get that pretty fast. It's not the full power of Radiance that you're used to. See, that crew just takes a little bit of damage from it. In the early stages of the game, it's a lot more powerful. Getting it later on is kind of like this thing of, I just need some damage, but I don't want to go Rapier. So how do I combat this? Well, I get Radiance. That gives me a little bit of pushing power. It's not a lot, but it works. And I have Sentry Wards. Radiant, I think. Do they sell that gem? Yeah, they sell that gem on Venomancer. Prophet continues to go up with the farm. Haste. Back in towards the mid lane too, Gosu. Rallying four heroes together here. Either they're looking for a smoke gank. Now they've got it too on VS. But their Radiant have a perfect ward. A perfect ward right now. They can see VS has that smoke. They can see where he is. And the area where Gosu are grouping up is almost perfect for it as well. That's the reason why we're seeing experience not really pushing anywhere. They don't want to take any unnecessary risks. And there goes the smoke. The ward didn't have vision of that. Well, they still know something's going on. And Gosu going the long way around. It's a smart thing to do right now because they realize that more than likely, Experience thinks they're going into Roshan. And that's exactly what Experience thinks they're going to go in themselves. Lotus sends the illusions. It's like, hang on, Roshan's not there. Where is Gosu? We can't see them. There's no ward. And they're going to find the courier. They're going to kill the courier. Everybody gets 150 gold. But they don't come out of the smoke, but they definitely reveal themselves out. The pipe will pop, Storm jumps in, the BKB is up. Paint throws down the wards, and in comes the Blinking Ravage, gets the entire of Gosu. The mech will pop to give him a little bit of life, but they're losing it very, very fast. Bulba trying to bring down Pycat. This time he does get that Hex off. Nice Stalker on very, very low life. Four staff away. Nature's Prophet wants out. He can't do so. The Gush from Titana will finish the job. Nice Stalker still on very, very low life. 1437 throws out the stun. Still not enough damage to kill him off because he popped off that bottle charge just in time. 1437 goes down again. Gosu is wiped. And now Experience will look for the push. Amazing that Experience managed to take that without losing a single hero. That was the more important thing for them. Not to mention, they didn't really have the best way of initiating. Nice Stalker is like, I'm in. Hoorah! Get the kill. But funny enough, the Courier. Courier, most valuable player for Experience. And at that point, Gosu shouldn't attack it. And they're probably going to look at this going, oh, there was nothing. It doesn't even matter if there's anything going on. The Courier doesn't drop items anymore. That's one of those things. If you're watching one of the matches, which I, 2 days ago, I think I made the comment where the Courier died just around on the side area, just around here. And I'm like, wow, we should really jump in to grab that. But that was in tournament mode. And we didn't notice until the game after that in tournament mode that the Courier goes under the new rules of the Courier. So if the Courier dies, 150 gold is given. He'll respawn in 3 minutes' time. but no items are dropped. I just thought I'd establish that one. Because I see Matt making a post in the comment on the YouTube video. I'm like, yeah, I just explained one of the future broadcasts. For all those guys out there who are like, yeah, I tune in to the broadcast. I love Dota 2. Every night, you know what? I just sit there. I'm on my couch. I'll have like my cat on one side, my dog on the other, the girlfriend sitting on the floor, and I'm just watching my Dota 2 stream. It's like, hell yeah, man. This is the life. This is the life. Still in the meantime, we'll watch the life of Gosu. 12k gold, the advantage in favor of experience. They still have their barracks. That is their upside. They still have their barracks. As long as they have their barracks, this doesn't matter. It's going to matter a little bit because the amount of farm that's up on some of these heroes is 300 CS. Mantastar fully done and 2700 gold. It's a lot of damage. That's a lot of fast damage as well. Let's watch this tower. Well, it's not going to drop. Fortification, in fact, coming up, and a TP's coming out as well. 1437 wants to kill. Can't do it. Loader, in fact, already having his Linker Sphere popped. And Miracle again with a perfect Ravage. Pyker jumps in inside BKB. 1437 is pulled in. Venomancer pops the ultimate off. Hitting on Bulba. And Loader, he's a long, long way from home. Needs a time lapse, but getting himself silenced a little bit too much, but then finally does manage the time lapse. Too much damage coming out. Pyker jumping himself around. 1437 while his Ankhast popped off. He will not have enough life to survive. Power Shot will fly through. The only hero to survive being Bulba. The Weaver just having enough time to pop off that time lapse. Reverse all the damage that was done to him. And the tier 2 tower, the last one outside the base of Gosu, goes down. Storm Spirit even gets himself the Scythe of Vice. And XP look to push down through the bottom lane. Tier 3 tower is what they want. Tier 3 tower is what they're going to get. Oh, I'm wrong, John Joe. Thank you very much for saying if the gem is on the courier, then it is dropped. Oh, Pycat up. Pull back in again. And Bulba, well, he's just silenced for a little bit. But the GG call comes out. All right, so, well, actually, that's the question. Like, is that 100% confirmed that the courier will drop the gem if it's killed? Because the changelog said items will not be dropped. So maybe one of those things to test out. It's the questions of the mechanics of Dota. Ooh. Someone can answer that. Those guys that do the Mythbusters for Dota, they can answer that. Dire's middle tower is under attack. But then again, they do it for Dota 1. What are they doing for Dota 2? Well, we can find out. Yeah. At the end of the day, though, it is GG. Everyone is disconnected bar Bulba, who is fighting to this bitter end. The funny thing is, almost everyone else is disconnected as well, bar Loader. Could be looking to finish this off. Bulba just needs a DC so we can officially end this game. We, of course, will be back here. As far as the next game's going, I'm just going to double check. Yeah, our next games are going to set up in just a moment. We might stick with this, and that might delay off our last game. We're going to just double check here. All right, yeah, so we'll be jumping into another game. I must host this up, so yes. We'll be jumping into our next game. Please officially finish this, Bulba. Just disconnect, damn you. All I want to see is the stat screen at the end. Give me a stat screen. Dire's middle tower is under attack. 21 CET. That's not when the match was supposed to be played, Holy. So it looks like the game times have been changed around, so we won't get to have experience. I'm just double checking this. Yeah, Dignitas versus Fnatic. We're going to jump into it. He doesn't want to quit. It doesn't matter. I must leave this game. The next game is coming up. Stick around. Dota 2 action coming to you in just a moment. That is not the outro. That's the outro.